Hi, it's Bob Kraft of TennisMinistry.org. We're following this up with a series on the pro players that basically I've been on the tour for 10 years and I've got the from the year 2000 to today, 2012. And I've spent a lot of time with players all the way up to number ones and just kind of talking through the situation with various players. Andy Murray is today's topic. Andy was someone that I met when he was 15, I believe. I was at the U.S. Open and there were a group of American players and a few other countries that were sitting together at a table. And I sat down with them and started talking to them. And there was one player that I had been introduced to through a USTA junior player, through a pastor who, this player's pastor. And he had written me and said, here, you know, make contact with this player. So I did. And, you know, I got to know all the USTA junior players from that time and also a few of the other players from other countries. One was Gil Monfils from France. He was at the table. And also Andy Murray. And, you know, he was someone that wasn't really super well known on the tennis scene. He was at least, you know, within the world's media. And I got emails of most of all the players, including him. And from that moment on, we just, you know, I saw him probably 2 or 3 years later, and he was just coming up into the men's tour. I was sitting at a table at the Australian Open with John Lloyd, and he had some of his Davis Cup players from England there. And John's been very supportive of me and for a number of years. And Andy was sitting right next to me, and Andy knew me from years before at the U.S. Open. And we exchanged emails again, and I shared the gospel as I do with players and him and talked. And, you know, he saw that I knew players that he looked up to, like John Lloyd and Martin Lee, who was one of the British players and some other ones. So, you know, he knew I was part of that group, and I was accepted. And from that moment on, whenever I see Andy Murray, he's always been friendly to me, nice. He allows me to be around, you know. He doesn't want me not around. I would say I'm not part of his inner circle. Once he came in at Wimbledon, there was a period of a few years later where he was at Wimbledon and he was starting to make a name for himself. You know, everybody in the British press was saying, we need a champion. It's probably going to be Andy Murray. It might be Tim Henman, you know. So Andy was in that mix in the press. And all of a sudden, Andy recruited, he had his mother, but he recruited these group of about six people to be around him. Now, part of it is they wanted to be around him because he's the man for England, and, you know, probably it helps their careers in some way. But all of a sudden, they were around him. And the thing I used with my strategy was, as far as talking to people, is I talk directly to the players. I don't talk through an agent or through even a parent if they're an adult. I talk directly to the player, and I'm not part of the entourage. I don't want to be part of the entourage. Entourages change frequently, and then also they're there for a purpose, which is to use that player, and vice versa, the player to use the entourage. And that's not where I'm from at all. That's not where I'm coming from. So I stayed away, and Andy paid attention to that. I wouldn't sit with this six or seven people, and I just told him, I said, listen, Andy, I said, when there's not everybody around you, that's when we can talk. We'll talk. And he shook his head and looked at me, and he understood. And so as I would see him at tournaments, I'd go up and talk to him, and he'd come over and talk to me. And he would start asking me spiritual questions. He said, he told me he was watching a movie on that's called something Demons, and, you know, he wanted to know what my opinion about it was. And one thing about Andy Murray, he was always willing to address things in public. He didn't want to get me in a corner because he was ashamed of the gospel. He would stand up and say, what do you think of this? And it'd be around his group of people or other people. He just wasn't ashamed. And I appreciated that about him. One time at Queen's Club, he was asking me a question about, and I prepared material for him to give him to read. One was someone on Eric Lindell, who was a famous Olympic gold medalist from Scotland who became a missionary. So I gave him that material, and he appreciated it. Thank you. And then another player who's a very low-ranked doubles player, but been on the tour a long time, started making fun of Andy to his face, you know. So what are you looking at that stuff for? You know, that's just rubbish. And, you know, I went over and told him. I mean, he did it right to his face in the public. So these are the obstacles that we have, you know. And it's very unfair. It's not right to do that to somebody. And Andy didn't say anything. He just sat down. But I didn't want him to be influenced by this particular player. So I went and sat with that player and I said, why'd you do that? I said, that's not necessary. And, you know, he apologized. And he's kind of an opponent of the gospel, you say. He criticizes me behind my back and things like that. And, you know, okay, so Andy knew I confronted him. And then, you know, I'd see Andy. I saw Andy at the Cincinnati tournament. And, you know, I gave him material. But I couldn't really, you have to gauge. He's got an entourage around him. You have to get in through the entourage. They don't necessarily want you around because it's just one more person that they have to compete against in a way. And a couple of the people with the group who's his physical trainer, you know, they're supportive of me, and there's others that aren't. And you just have to find Andy when he's by himself, and sometimes he'll come over and talk to me. The thing is, I just told Andy, I said, listen, Andy, I said, I don't know if God will make you a number one player in the world. I don't know. I don't have the answer to that. I said, only God knows that. But I said, I do know that you need to give him credit. Wow. That's a powerful statement, okay? Because it wasn't about using God. It was about falling in love with God. And that's the message that I sent to him. And, you know, he's never publicly acknowledged that he believes. He may or may not, but for sure there hasn't been any acknowledgement of that. Whereas with Novak Djokovic, there has, truthfully. And I always recognized that between Andy Murray and Novak Djokovic, that they were the ones that were competing for the top prize in the sport. Who will be number one after Nadal, after Federer? And even I can't predict that, but I do know that God loves someone who gives him credit. And so I saw Judy, his mother, at different in the airports, at different places, and in Cincinnati in the hotel. And I gave her a material that talked about the basics of faith. And she told me, I said, please get this to Andy. And she said, okay. She said, I'll read it myself first. And, you know, that's the best I can do, because it talks about, you know, what a church is, and, you know, why Christ is important to the church, and the kind of the steps of faith. Because obviously, if you're from Scotland, the church is in Scotland. There's a lot of famous missionaries, and the mission movement of the world has actually come from Scotland in the modern history. And so Scotland has played an important role to Christian history. And, you know, it's my prayer that that God can just work in that family. There, he has a mother and father are split. And, you know, he has his brother. I've spoken to his brother quite a lot, and I don't see him very often. He's a very good doubles player. But for sure, I like Andy, and he's a nice person to other people. And I think he wants to be nice, but I think there's also the side of him where people are trying to get around him, and he just can't trust people. So it's my prayer that God will put it in his heart to trust Christ first. Thanks.